एक समय था जब गरीबी से लड़ने की जरूरत थी, अब वो समय आया है जब सांप्रदायिकता से लड़ने की जरूरत है।
Struggle against communalism can be properly waged by young people like you if you constantly interact with your with people who are around you.
People are having so much of myths regarding Muslim community.
हमारे खेलों तक पे असर देखने को मिलता है।
अपने निजी स्वार्थों के लिए, निजी लाभ के लिए वो पूरे शहर का, पूरे समाज का माहौल बिल्कुल खराब कर देते
हैं। I refuse to believe that a majority of our media is spreading hate or prejudice.
आपस में इस तरह की चीजें चलती रहे, समाज बटा रहे, उनको रोटियां सेकने का जो मौका मिलता रहे।
Generally, the people who perpetuate these crimes, they get away without getting any punishment.
Suppose such a carnage breaks out around you, what are you going to do?
Don't forget Afghanistan, don't forget Taliban, don't forget that these are the consequences of great internal strife produced by the same factors at work in our part of the world. Don't forget that.
Fascism in India will not come in the form in which it has come in Europe. Fascism in India will come in the form of communism.
Even if not in the short run, I'm quite optimistic in the long run it will be defeated. It has to be defeated because it cannot survive. Because history has not been shaped like this. And history will come to the rescue of the future of a great nation like India.
When we look at the relationship between communalism and women, there are at least two aspects to it which we should be aware of. The first aspect is what many of us might be more familiar with, but I will go over it briefly. And that is the understanding that there is a particular way in which communities have defined their identity and sense of pride. Assertion of their identity has been marked on the bodies of women. Now, this is a phenomenon that we are familiar with, whether it's the burqa or whether it's the ghungat or whether it's the bindi. There is a way in which community identity has to be marked on the body of the woman. There are particular markers that of identity that men have too, of community identity. There is the pagri. There is, for example, maybe a certain kind of topi. But the interesting thing is that if you look at the kinds of markers that mark male bodies as belonging to a particular community, those markers are markers of izzat. Pagri is a sign of izzat. But the markers that mark a woman's body are markers of lajja or large. So whether it's ghungat or bindi or burqa, the idea is that the community's large and lajja and shame is protected by the woman who covers her body in that way. It's not that communities don't mark male bodies, but they mark female bodies in a specific way. This particular phenomenon of marking community identity on the bodies of women is particularly obvious in minority communities which feel that their identity is under threat, is under attack. So after the demolition of the Babri Masjid in 92, with the greater sense of insecurity among the Muslims in India, you find that particular kind of head-to-foot burqa makes its appearance in Kerala. We read recently about Lashkar-e-Jabbar in Kashmir, which has insisted, you may know, passed a decree that all Muslim women should wear the burqa. Two women were in fact beheaded recently for not wearing the burqa. But more interestingly, they appeal to Hindu and Sikh sisters to wear, sisters, we appeal to our Hindu and Sikh sisters to wear a bindi so that you can be spared from attack if you don't wear a veil. Now, you can see the same kinds of ways in which the other is being homogenized, because as you know, Sikhs don't wear bindis. But what is interestingly happening here is that the right wing of all communities is apparently completely at home marking the bodies of their women in various ways. And in a way, the Lashkar-e-Jabbar statement is saying, all right, you put on the marks of your community and we'll make sure our women put on the marks of our community. And all of us men will keep all our women in place. So there is this particular phenomenon of a minority community feeling threatened, marking the bodies of its women, drawing them inside. But you see the same phenomenon in the case of majority communities, which feel threatened by globalization, by the West. And there are certain kinds of values which are coming from the West, which are supposed to be polluting, which pollute our pure tradition, which destroy our pure tradition. There is an Iranian scholar, Ali Shariati, who termed the phrase Westoxification. That is toxicity, poison, Westoxification, that is poison coming from the West. So you find majority community, you find Hindu right-wing politics in India plays upon that fear continuously when it attacks beauty contests, when it attacks Valentine's Day. Beauty contests were attacked in a similar way by the majority Muslim community in Nigeria, because of course feminists are also opposed to beauty contests, but for completely different reasons, in fact for completely an opposite set of reasons. When right-wing forces attack beauty contests on the grounds that women are exposing their bodies and so on, the understanding is that the body of the woman is the repository of the honor of my community, in this case India as a whole, and that body is ours to control, to define, to mark, and to draw inside the four walls of the home. So to parade nude on the stage before the eyes of the world is not a shame for that woman individually. It's a shame for me, because I am the man whom she's shaming by parading herself, because my community identity and my respect lies in her being fully covered and sitting inside the four walls of my home. This is that very strange way in which the displacement takes place, that the shaming, she's not apparently shamed by it, the man is shamed by it, so he has to drag her off the stage. So the right-wing and traditionalist kind of responses to beauty contests are very clearly coming from an understanding which wants to curtail women's autonomy, curtail their space, bring them back into the four walls of the home. But if you look at the feminist responses and the feminist critiques of beauty contests, they come from a completely different perspective. And they come from an understanding that through something like beauty contests, the bodies of women are being commodified. They are being transformed into objects that can be bought and sold. They are being objectified. As you know, beauty contests don't simply give the Miss India or Miss World crown. You will notice that Sunsilk will sponsor Miss Beautiful Hair, Colgate will sponsor Miss Beautiful Teeth, Lakme will sponsor Miss Beautiful Nails. And there is a way in which literally the body of the woman is being broken up into little bits and sold off to different multinationals. When you're a woman beauty contest contestant, you are the complete woman. You are a complete woman only if you're completely beautiful as well. Whereas men can be rocket scientists, they can be prime ministers, they can also be models. But the ideal woman is, as Sushmita Sen famously said, the essence of Indian womanhood is beauty plus this, plus that, plus the other thing. So the feminist critique of beauty contests has to do with recovering the autonomy of women, recovering the body of women for themselves. And now what this means is that therefore no feminist will ever, I haven't heard any feminist groups or individuals make a demand for banning beauty contests. Because we don't believe that a ban on duty contests is the answer. As long as society is constructed in such a way that women have so few options for professions, you look at any profession and the top posts are absolutely monopolized by men, by, of course, also Hindu upper caste men, mostly Brahmins. But anyway, that's a different matter. We'll discuss that at another level. But if you take even a profession like teaching, first of all, teaching is heavily female dominated because it's very low paid. Then when you look at the lowest rung where there is the highest work and the lowest pay, nursery school teaching, it's 100% women. You go to the top where there are professors, there are very few women, it's mostly men. Take Valentine's Day, which I find absolutely fascinating. Why is the Hindu right so hysterical about Valentine's Day? They get so violent. Anyone who is in Delhi University knows the kind of tamasha that goes on around February 14th. It becomes difficult for teachers to hang around with their male colleagues because you never know when they're going to come and start flinging pamphlets at you and so on. What is it? What is bothering them quite so much? The reason why the Hindu right fears Valentine's Day is that Valentine's Day represents romance, love, which is assumed to be between two individuals. And there is always the potential that love carries, love with a capital L carries, of forgetting the social hierarchy, social differences. There's always the potential because you fall in love. You don't really think about who you're going to fall in love with. And when you open your eyes, then it is possibly someone of the wrong caste or the wrong community or the wrong class. There is that potential. There is that subversive potential in love, which Valentine's Day represents, which is what Hindutva Vadis are worried about. Because a society in which such hierarchies are not maintained, in which individuals go around having relationships which may not be marriage, which may or may not end in marriage, that's a society which they cannot control. And their fear is precisely that. And in some ways, I began to look at Valentine's Day with new and more positive eyes when I realized that the Hindutva Vadis were so opposed to it. And if you look at the way in which communalism works, it is very, very crucial for the family to remain the way it is, which is currently patriarchal, patrilineal, okay, patriarchal in terms of its power structures, patrilineal in terms of the way in which property passes, the way in which the name of the family passes, extremely authoritarian and hierarchical. I don't think we recognize, all of us, to what extent the family is actually a completely constructed and imagined institution. If you look at the history of the family in this country alone, in my lifetime alone, I think you will find that there have been different forms of family. What we consider to be the family, which is father, mother, two children, one Maruti and one dog, is not actually some kind of natural thing like a tree. My nani lived with her brothers. She did not live with my nana. That was the family structure, that you sisters lived with their brothers, the sisters had children by one man or many men, it didn't matter. But all those children were looked after by sisters and their brothers. And the brothers' children lived with their mothers in their households with their mamas. And the males in their lives were their mamas. This was not something bizarre. It was not something extraordinary. It was something perfectly normal and natural for the Nair community of Kerala. Now, so this is as late as 1972, my grandmother, my nani died. As late as that, this was an ordinary enough arrangement. In Meghalaya, as you know, there are some forms of matrilineal arrangements still. My point is that if the family is an institution that has come about because people need intimacy, they need love, they need sexual relationships, they need children, they need people to depend on, they need people who look after them, then such arrangements can happen outside the sort of thing that you call the family today. The purpose of the family as it exists today is not simply that people want to live together and be happy together. There are two reasons why the family exists. It is meant to keep the patriarchal property structure going. It's very, very crucial to know who the father of the child is because the property has to pass to the child of that man. Those of you who have seen this film, Mrityudand, will remember the stunning scene in which Shabana is pregnant by another man and Madhuri Dixit asks her, "Ye kiska bacha hai?" And she says, "Mera." And whichever theater you saw it in, you will remember that there was a halbali in the audience. It was like, what is she saying? Now, on the other hand, how absurd that question is. Kiska bacha hai? It's in her body. She's 7 months pregnant. It's very obvious kiska bacha hai. But the point is that a bacha is never a woman's bacha. In a patriarchal society, the mother's name simply doesn't matter. As you know, it was as late as 1990s that a court case had to be fought so that you can write your mother's name on your, when you apply for your HSC exam. As late as the 1990s, that someone had to go to court to say that writing the mother's name should be equally valid. Just to illustrate this a little bit, I want to tell you about a judgment in a case which Nandita Haksar talks about. Many of you may be familiar with her and know her name. She's a very well-known human rights activist and feminist lawyer. And she has written about a Delhi High Court judgment in 1984 in which the judge declared, I won't go into the details of the case, but in which the judge declared that you cannot apply the fundamental rights, Articles 14 and 15, to the family. Articles 14 and 15, the rights to freedom and equality, cannot be applied to the family. Letting fundamental rights into the family, he said, and now I'm quoting, is like letting a bull into a china shop. You all know what this phrase means. It means basically it would be utterly destructive. It would break up the family. Now the point is, do we want to sustain institutions in which equality and liberty cannot be sustained? So when I say that we do want, that the whole critique that feminists make of these kinds of things are implicitly about a critique of the family, this is what I mean. Not that we want to break up families and make everybody unhappy, but we do want to transform the nature of the family as it exists, because the family as it exists is at the root of various kinds of structures of inequality, and this is precisely what communalism feeds off. In communal violence, there's a particular kind of focus on raping women. I think we're very aware of why that is, because there are mass rapes of Dalit women by upper caste men and so on. And this is, of course, a way of shaming the family to which the women belong. It's like, I'll burn your hut and I'll rape your women. It's part of your property. It's something you couldn't protect. You have proved yourself to be unmanly. You have proved that you cannot look after your property well. The second aspect is a very uncomfortable aspect, which we have not actually sufficiently engaged with, and we've become aware of only more recently, which is, of course, the fact that women are active in communal violence. And women are particularly active in our experience in communal violence of the Hindu right. They have been mobilized for extremely violent actions from the demolition of the Babri Masjid onwards, particularly in Gujarat. If anybody saw it, they would forget the chilling sight of, on Newstrack, women sitting on a terrace laughing and talking, and the way they would make achar or the way they would cut vegetables together, they're sitting and making little firebombs with little pieces of saris to throw on their Muslim neighbors. I don't think anybody will forget that image in a hurry. And we know how active women were in the entire violence and how actively they participated, both in that and the anti-Mandala agitations, where the upper caste women were so active in protesting the reservations. I think we assumed that there is a secular feminist identity where you never have to say what caste or community you are. And it's only the right-wing casteist and communal people who will say what caste and community they are. But in fact, I think we have to come to terms with the fact that the only people who can afford to say that I have no caste and no community are the powerful upper caste people. Today, who can say I don't know my caste? Only if you have been born into a caste which has entry everywhere, where nobody stops you, only then can you afford to say I don't even know my caste. If you're born a Dalit, you know your caste before you're born, because there are large areas of the world which are prohibited to you. As a teacher for many years, I have made statements about Kashmir, that Kashmir should have, you know, there should be a plebiscite and so on, which would be read very differently if my name were Farida Khan. That person would go home, my students would go home and say, this is what Muslims say. They say Kashmir should be. And this is not something that I'm just making up. I know Muslim friends and teachers who have said the same thing, and it's read very differently than when Nivedita Menon says it. So to say that I'm not a Hindu or I'm not a Muslim or I don't really care makes no sense, because you know, everybody knows who you are from your name. Everybody knows. And if a Dalit says, I don't care about caste, then it means something very different from when a Brahmin says, I don't care about caste. And we have to ask how and why. My point is that location does matter. Location, where you are located, which community. And this is a very difficult recognition for feminists and the women's movement to come to terms with, because it means we are saying that all women will not respond in the same way. Now, I just want to remind you what I said, that what is at the heart of all these discussions is always the family. And the family is somehow described as personal. You know that they all call personal laws, Hindu personal law. It's personal. The family is apparently personal, but there is a law which the state will ensure stays in place. And the family is apparently personal, but there are very, very strict legal rules about what you can do and what you cannot do in a family, and to whom your property will go. If you look at the debate around the Uniform Civil Code, now each of these religious personal laws discriminates against women. Each and every one of them. Hindu, Muslim, Sikhs don't have a separate personal law. Christian, Parsi, each and every personal law discriminates against women. But the debate about the Uniform Civil Code has never been about the rights of women. If you listen to the Uniform Civil Code debate, if you come from another country or from another planet and listen to the debate on the Uniform Civil Code, you will think the debate on the Uniform Civil Code is about national integrity versus community rights. Those who are for Uniform Civil Code are for the nation. Those who are against Uniform Civil Code are against the nation. This is one form of the debate. From the other side, from those who are against the Uniform Civil Code, the argument is something like this, that in a democracy, minority communities have the right to their own identity. As minority communities, we demand the right to have these laws. So if you are for the Uniform Civil Code, you're anti-minority rights and anti-democracy. Till the mid-80s, the women's movement demanded a Uniform Civil Code on the grounds that women don't have equal rights. Till the mid-80s, till even 84, 85. But something happens in the mid-80s which transforms in the Indian polity. One is the Shah Bano judgment. And you have the beginning of the Ayodhya movement. Now, interestingly, the Shah Bano judgment, so what is the story as we know it of the Shah Bano judgment? A Muslim woman claims maintenance under the law. She's granted maintenance by the Supreme Court from her divorced husband. And then the Muslim backward reactionary Muslim community opposes this, insists that the government withdraw, overrule the Supreme Court judgment through a legislation. The Muslim women's law is passed, and Muslim women are taken out of the purview of Section 125 of the Criminal Procedure Code, which is the section under which Shah Bano had gone to court. Now, if you look at the story, it's actually, you can tell it in a very different way. You can understand the story in a very different way. Because Shah Bano, in fact, did not go to court under any religious personal law. She went under a purely secular provision, Section 125 of the Criminal Procedure Code, under which, because what it's saying is, don't become a vagrant, don't become a beggar on the road. We have no responsibility to give you employment, but your family has a responsibility to look after you. Really, Section 125, that's what it's about. Section 125 is meant to force families to look after people who would otherwise become beggars on the road and be a burden on the state. When this judgment comes out in this way, with these words in the judgment, the Ayodhya movement is on the rise. You know, Hindu right-wing politics is on the rise. Obviously, the most backward reactionary elements in the Muslim community rally to the defense of their community. And they approach the government to say, take Muslim women out of the purview of this section. But another fact that we don't hear enough about is that there were as many, if not more, representations to the government from Muslims saying, do not overturn the Supreme Court judgment. Those of you who lived in Delhi at that time will remember the processions in Delhi and in other parts of the country, burqa-clad women, thousands of them saying, don't remove this, don't overturn this judgment. We have come to understand that uniformity does not necessarily mean equality. Uniformity does not necessarily mean justice. The term that we now use is gender-just civil code. Now, when I say uniformity does not necessarily mean justice, a good example to go to is the Hindu court bills, which all the judges have claimed is the great indicator of Hindu progressiveness. You find that if you look at the Hindu court bill, you find that what it did not reform Hindu laws. There is no one Hindu practice. There are hundreds of Hindu practices. The festivals are not the same. I don't know how many North Indians have even heard of Onam, which is a very, very important festival for Hindus of Kerala. We don't celebrate Diwali. It's not a festival of Kerala. And Holi is not a festival of the Hindus of the South. And so on and so forth. I mean, a Kerala Muslim will have much more in common with a Kerala Hindu or Christian than with a UP Muslim. There are hundreds and hundreds of practices. Marriage practices are not the same all over the country. What is called a marriage ceremony in the North is not, etc., etc. What the Hindu court bill did was it recognized certain things to be Hindu practices, and the standard on which that recognition was made was that North Indian upper caste practices were considered to be the norm. So, for example, Saptapadi around the fire is defined as marriage. We don't have Saptapadi around the fire. We in fact, Nayars can have a marriage without even a priest because it's a contract. A marriage among Nayars is a contract. You can do it in front of elders and you're married. But what happens with this is, it's not simply that, you know, they recognize. What happens is that actual problems like bigamy, which are supposed to be illegal among Hindus, in fact, Hindus can get away with bigamy if they simply don't follow the Saptapadi practice. If you marry once and then you marry a second time And maybe in both cases, you've only exchanged garlands or exchanged rings or any other form of marriage. Or if you've done Saptapadi once but done exchange of garlands later, neither wife can go to court and say you're bigamous, because then you have not legally married the second woman. And so you have no obligations to either. This particular codification has taken away the rights of many women of many communities. The Hindu Custodianship and Guardianship Act introduced a new category which never existed before, which is the concept of the natural guardian of a child. And it said that the natural guardian of a child is, surprise, surprise, the father. So what it means is, therefore, that from the early 50s, there has been a new addition which never existed in any Hindu practice before, that the natural custodian of the child is the father, and therefore, in case of a divorce, that's the interesting thing. Till 5, the child needs its mother. So as long as the nappies have to be changed and the dirty work has to be done, the child has to remain with the mother, and then goes to the natural custodian. So this is a myth that the Hindu code bills have given rights to women. In many cases, they've taken away rights from women. The point is gender justice. The point is not uniformity. The point is not the integrity of the nation. The point is gender justice. And what is the way in which we can bring that about?
इन काली सदियों के सर से जब रात का आंचल ढलकेगा
जब दुख के बादल पिघलेंगे जब सुख का सागर छलके
जब अंबर झूम के नाचेगा जब धरती नगमे गाएगी वो सुबह कभी तो आएगी वो सुबह कभी